Tonight, we're talking about one of the most controversial subjects in corporate governance and responsibility today, woke capitalism. Should a company's goal remain shareholder primacy? What does ESG mean for the future of free enterprise? Joining us today, we have a great panel to discuss these issues. Moderating our panel discussion tonight is James Copeland. James Copeland is a senior fellow at the Manhattan Institute and director of legal policy. He's the author of The Unelected. He previously served as a management consultant with McKinsey and law clerk for Ralph K. Winter on the Second Circuit Court of Appeals. He's a director at two privately held manufacturing companies. He served on many public and nonprofit boards and is a graduate of Yale Law School and School of Management. Our panelists are, first, Erica Karp. She is the Chief Impact Officer at Pathstone and previously founded Cornerstone Capital Group, an impact investment advisory firm. During 25 plus years on Wall Street, she developed a deep belief in ESG analysis as critical to investing. Previously, Ms. Karp was Managing Director and Head of Global Sector Research at UBS Investment Bank. She speaks frequently on sustainable investing around the world and holds an MBA from Columbia University. Vivek Ramaswamy is founder and executive chairman of Roivant Sciences. Roivant is focused on developing transformative medicines faster by building technologies and deploying talent in creative ways, and has developed over 40 medicines in multiple disease areas. He is also the author of Woke Inc., which is forthcoming, and a graduate of Yale Law School. Allison Schrager is a senior fellow at the Manhattan Institute and a City Journal contributing editor, where her research focuses on public finance, pensions, tax policy, labor markets, and monetary policy. She is the author of An Economist Walks Into a Brothel and co-founder of Lifecycle Finance Partners, LLC, a risk advisory firm. Mr. Copeland will lead our panel through 40 to 45 minutes of discussion, followed by 15 to 20 minutes of audience Q&A. You can submit your questions through the Slido tab at any point during our program. Now I'd like to welcome to the floor Jim Copeland. Jim, welcome to you. Welcome to all of our panelists. Thank you all for joining us. Jim, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Greg, and thanks to all our participants in the Adam Smith Society. It's just been Adam Smith's been a remarkable success for the Manhattan Institute, and I'm honored to help lead this distinguished panel tonight to talk about really the fundamental the fundamental question going into business. What is the purpose of the corporation? Is that to make money for shareholders, or is it something broader than that, as some have argued? And this is an old argument dating back more than 100 years. Should the managers and the corporate board members' fiduciary responsibilities rest only with the equity shareholders or a broader set of stakeholders? So this is the first fundamental question we want to answer. And I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Allison Schrager, the economist, to lead us off.
So I guess my opinion is, yes, I believe that focusing on shareholder value, which is profit, is actually in the best interest, not only of shareholders, but in terms of society at large. They wrote recently in City Journal, you know, when you have multiple stakeholders, you know, whose values matter more and how much you weight them, you know, is always an open question. And effectively, it really always comes down to values. And I think a big problem we have right now is not recognizing that a lot of us have different values, but all those values are valid. So, you know, if you're a company and you're thinking about moving a factory from Michigan to Alabama, I mean, who matters more? Is it the stakeholders in Michigan or is it the stakeholders in Alabama? You know, this really often does come down to values. And once you introduce values, I think we're seeing that things get very political very quickly. And then it becomes, politics then definitely becomes into the boardroom. And I think we're seeing more and more that no good really can come from that. And, you know, if you at least focus on profits, it's objective, it's easy to measure. You know, I think as we're going to discuss, sometimes politics can seep into the discussion, but at least you minimize it to a large extent.
All right, Erica, I think you may have a slightly different view. You obviously focus on ESG investing and have made a career out of it. So what's your point of view on this?
Personally, there's no such thing as ESG investing. We should put that on the table first. ESG analysis, that's a thing. And it is a discipline that we use when we are investing. And by the way, that's any kind of investing. Impact investing, sustainable investing, values-based investing. It's all just investing. ESG analysis is a critical lens. That said, I think sometimes we have a false dichotomy in terms of, you know, stakeholders. Who comes first? You know, is it our shareholders, our employees, our communities? Who comes first? Nobody comes first. This has to be held in conjunction. If we are seeking to maximize financial profits, which is good, and we should, and the corporation is about the corporation, but if we're seeking to do that, then we have to think about all our stakeholders. You know, if you have miserable employees and you have miserable customers, you're not going to maximize the price of the stock, right? So when it comes to thinking about material, environmental, social, and governance issues, these are fundamental. And if you don't think about those issues, in the long run, you are not going to maximize profitability, and you're going to miss both risks and opportunities. So yes, as a lover of capitalism and the corporate, you know, governance of the world, I think you can do both. False dichotomy.
Okay, Vivek, I think you are a relatively well-known critic of that idea, that it's possible to do a broader stakeholder view for the purpose of the corporation. Why?
So I'd like to actually say that I agree with Allison's conclusions, but I agree on very different grounds. And so while Allison makes a compelling case that we want to keep politics out of the boardroom, I actually think perhaps the most important and under-discussed consideration in the last couple of years around this debate has actually been keeping corporate power out of the public square in the classical sense of what we mean in an Athenian conception of democracy, the idea that we have a public square where we engage in open debate and deliberation and settle our society's most important moral questions, not through force, not through the use of market power, but through the use of open debate in an idea-based meritocracy where the best ideas rise to the top and where no one's voice is either amplified or silenced based on the number of dollars they wield in the marketplace. And to me, that is the fundamental error of stakeholder capitalism, is that it is actually citizens united on steroids. And it's funny to me that this is now viewed as a progressive idea, because progressives 10 years ago hated the Citizens United ruling because it permitted corporations to exert some influence on our democracy through electoral contributions. Whereas today, this new philosophy of stakeholder capitalism actually demands that corporations not only wield market power, but wield power in the marketplace of ideas. And Jim, I think that's actually a dangerous expansion of corporate power that goes far beyond what at least one version of the initial conception of the American corporation was all about, which was actually to put limits on the spheres of power that corporations could exercise, to say that the reason we want you to maximize value for shareholders isn't just to maximize profits or efficiency of the firm and isn't just for those shareholders, but is actually to keep Frankenstein's monster in his cage, to stay in the lane of the pursuit of products in the marketplace, precisely to protect democracy from the overreach of capitalism itself, so that we don't have the birth of the Dutch East India Company in modern clothing. And yet that's exactly what we see with the rise of Silicon Valley and big tech, I think is effectively a good example of what the modern version of a Dutch East India Company looks like. And so similar conclusion to Allison, very different grounds. I agree with much of what she has to say. Actually, I agree with some of what Erica has to say too. I think we may disagree about whether we actually need a new description like ESG or stakeholder capitalism to describe that movement.
Sorry,
I'm skeptic as to why we use those words.
Erica, Allison, do you have a comment there?
No, I mean, I think Vivek and I are really on the same page. I think once you bring politics into the boardroom, you're also bringing it into the public square. These are the same thing. But I also agree with Erica that, you know, profits and taking care of other stakeholders aren't mutually exclusive. But at least when you're pursuing a shareholder model, you can justify valuing different shareholders based on profit. And that gives you some ability to make value judgments in a way that's objective. And I think that's what's important about it.
You know, the only thing I would add is that, yeah, we all agree that you want to keep politics out of business. And I believe that, you know, things can be made political. It can be politicized when it's not the intent, right? So we talk about sustainable and impact investing. This should be about pragmatism. This should be about an enhanced analytical lens. This is not about ideology, or I don't think it should be. And so I understand, I believe that in the final analysis, when it comes to the asset owners, then it is about values. But I believe at the place that we are, that we operate in the company, then it's actually about transparency, I think, more so than values. When I say transparency, when we think about corporate disclosures of material ESG factors, they disclose. There should be transparency, and then the asset owners, they decide, right? So I don't think it has to be about values. Yes, we all have our own values, but when it comes to the corporation, if a corporation is transparent about, as an entity, you know, what it stands for, then I think it's okay, you know?
Yeah, so Jim, if I may draw two distinctions that I'd like to parse, to maybe go scratch one level deeper than some of the conversations that I've been a part of in the past have gone. And if I may take the liberty, I know we have a highly intellectual audience here, I'm told, so I'll take the liberty of maybe scratching a level deeper. I actually think there's a couple different versions of stakeholder capitalism. And since we're still in the first half of this debate, I'd like to debate discussion, whatever we call it. I'd like to maybe take an opportunity to draw a couple of distinctions. First is, I think, what we can think of as executive-driven stakeholder capitalism, where corporate executives are using their seat of corporate power, including shareholder resources, to decide what social causes a corporation ought and ought not advance. That's very different than something like the ESG, and I understand your hesitation with the term ESG investing, Erica, but for lack of a better term, ESG-informed investing. You know, that's actually the shareholders themselves demanding that the executives advance certain ideas espoused by the ESG movement. There's no alleged breach of fiduciary duty. Rather, these are what the shareholders actually are demanding. And both of those are different still from the phenomenon of what I call woke consumerism, which is when the consumers themselves are making demands upon the firm, and where the old school capitalists in the seat of both the executives and the shareholders may just say, actually, because consumers are demanding it, the thing that we're actually doing is pursuing profit by giving way to this new dialogue about corporations pontificating or even pushing social values. So I think it's really important, wherever you are on this debate, to at least be really precise about where your critique is directed. And I think as a critic of all three forms of stakeholder or woke capitalism, I also want to be the first to say that not all critiques apply equally to each of the forms of this new trend that we're seeing. And the other distinction I wanted to draw at the outset was also the idea that there's two versions of stakeholder capitalism, one of which I find more sympathetic than the other, both of which I'm against, but one of which I find a lot more sympathetic than the other. There's sort of the affirmative version of stakeholder capitalism, which is that corporations need to take on affirmative values, write checks to Black Lives Matter, stop climate change today, whatever it is, a social value that somebody thinks is good, to use corporate power to be able to ultimately effectuate that value in our world for the better. That's what I call affirmative stakeholder capitalism. That's really different from what is the negative externality conception of stakeholder capitalism, which is to say that if you're a cigarette manufacturer, if you're Marlboro, and you know there's an addictive ingredient and it isn't illegal to include it, that you should exercise restraint in not including that addictive ingredient if you think it's going to kill more people as a consequence. Basically a do no harm, or at least do less harm principle. I think that's actually a much more sympathetic account of stakeholder capitalism. What we're seeing in the difference between stakeholder capitalism and what I call truly woke capitalism is actually the woke movement effectively says that the distinction between those two conceptions is an illusion. Because the negative externalities of capitalism itself are so wrought that the inequities we see, racial disparities, impact on climate change, those are externalities of capitalism itself that corporations themselves have to espouse these new social causes, or else they're actually not addressing their own negative externalities. And so I think that, agree or not, that's, I think, the heart and most intellectually compelling account of the woke supercharged version of stakeholder capitalism that we're seeing on display over the course of the last 6 months. And I sort those things into categories before we started debating them.
I think Erica's got something to say.
Well, I can't resist because, well, first of all, you know, again, I'm going to go back to the issue of transparency. The company, the tobacco company, the oil company, the, you know, whichever, can do whatever the hell they want as long as they are transparent about what they're doing. and then hopefully the capital doesn't flow to them as easily, and they destroy themselves naturally. So that would be cool. And that's not political. Hold on a second. But one of the things that's cool about transparency is that there's an authenticity about it, right? And the world, I mean, this massive intergenerational transfer of wealth, like $50 trillion over this coming generation, they are demanding authenticity. And so I have to tell you that when I heard the title of this session, you know, Woke Capitalism, I think there are people that would argue that this is kind of an appropriation of a Gen Z progressive ideology. So I think that, I found it a little problematic, but I think that we have to be thoughtful about that degree of self-analysis, right? Holding that mirror up. It's the same as white privilege, right? We all have to hold that mirror up and say, what do we know? What do we not know? How can we be really authentic and connected so that we can move money, trillions, towards, you know, what I call sustainable capitalism? So I just had to get that in for, like, you know, the term woke just kind of gets me a little bit. Sorry, Jim.
Well, Vivek, you've got it in the title of your book. So do you want to respond quickly, and then we'll try to turn to Allison and get to some of these other issues that I want to get into. I've got a lot to say on these topics too. But
I know you
keep
do, Jim.
Moving.
Yeah, and Jim is actually I should confess has actually been one of the people who's been instrumental helping me with my book. But nonetheless, I wanted to close one loop with Erica, and then perhaps let's move on to the next sort of topic in the agenda. The loop I want to close is actually on a point of agreement. I think that authenticity is fundamental and important, and is what actually everyone on both, or most people on both sides of this debate, are demanding. But I want to get, again, I'm going to ask for forbearance of the audience here to get a little bit analytical here. I want to parse one thing you said, where the capital flows would actually chase those opportunities. If oil companies do whatever the hell they want to do, less capital is going to flow there. That means they're going to be punished, as the so-called term of art goes in capital markets today, as sin stocks. All that means is, if you're punished from a capital outflow, that means that you're ultimately going to have to reward investors with a higher expected rate of return to be able to hold that same stock, which means somebody else has a chance to make more money from owning it, which is all that means. And Cliff Asness has made this argument as well, is that ESG investing ought to, in principle, yield systematically lower returns than non-ESG oriented investing or ESG informed investing, precisely because disinvestment from so-called sin stocks should create a greater expected return for somebody else. That's not a bad thing. It's not a good thing. It's a part of the virtue of what it means to be value-oriented or social value-oriented, ESG-oriented investing. Now, I'll come back to the point about authenticity.
Do I have to add, though?
If I may just close the loop.
Let's let Vivek go first.
And then I want to hear the response. But about your point about authenticity, which I couldn't agree about more, this is where it comes back and bites me, because bites all of us. When Larry Fink issues statements on behalf of BlackRock that ESG investments ought to reward investors at a higher rate of return than portfolios that aren't ESG informed. If you weren't saying ESG and you substitute any other value on the basis of performance characteristics about the future, the SEC in any other context would be all over that. And yet, because it's dressed up in the apparent progressivism of ESG investing, we let it go. In fact, when it even counters the very narrative that the expected returns from what you disinvested from had to be higher to compensate people to hold those stocks. So that's the inauthenticity that actually bothers me most. Not to say that all ESG oriented investors suffer from that inauthenticity, but I think folks like BlackRock certainly do.
Well, we can talk about that because, you know, there's agreement there. But you have to remember, ESG, it's not values. It's just about transparency. Why would you not want more information rather than less, right? ESG investing, it's not about values. It's about transparency and good research. It's about going down avenues of inquiry that are about revenues and costs and risk. It's fundamental. It's not about values. And by the way, if I like smoking, drinking, gambling, and carrying guns while I'm riding a horse, that's my values. And so I might buy companies that facilitate that. But, and by the way, I don't really mean that. But my point is, it's about the values of the ultimate shareholder. ESG analysis is simply more information.
I want to push back on that a little bit. in the sense that, I mean, that's certainly the way you view it, Erica, but I mean, we just saw this proxy season, ExxonMobil had two directors replaced. That wasn't a transparency move. That was a hedge fund that was an impact investment hedge fund with a tiny stake in the company. And it was the shareholder voting dominated by proxy advisory firms, of which there are two that are largely subject to capture based on the empirical literature by public employee pension funds and social investing funds, and by these massive holders of passive investment wealth who aren't actual stock pickers at all. This is what BlackRock's basic bread and butter is that gives Larry Fink his voting power. They're just checking off the boxes on the S&P 500, according to what Standard & Poor's says. And then because they're the fiduciary owners of all this capital, they're voting shares. So these things can actually be much more than just transparency. I'd also argue, but I've long said, if it's material to an investor, then it should be disclosed. I don't think that's the case for everything that people are pushing for, but certainly if it's material, it should be disclosed. Allison, I'm going to go to you because you haven't had a chance to talk in a while. And if you want to respond to any of this, and if not, I want to turn to some of the more specific questions about corporate political activism, and we'll come back to these gatekeepers in a minute.
I mean, I'm curious with Erica, I understand what she's saying about ESG, but when you look at the ESG funds that are out there, do you think they're promoting transparency? I mean, certainly the ones that exist, because I don't get the sense that that a lot of the funds, I said, we brought up BlackRock, really do. I mean, I think a lot of people don't really know what they're investing in or really what the values are.
I think you're absolutely right. I think that many of the funds out there really don't, they're kind of labeled, right? So to do deep, proper ESG analysis, it's real work. And so I understand about 90% of the new ESG funds out there are relabeled from existing funds. It's not integral. It's not in their DNA. And the reason I talk about, you know, disclosure a lot is because we have major data problems and with all these funds and all these indices, right? Because you don't have good corporate disclosure, or at least not consistent and decision useful. So there's all of these data, you know, pieces of data that are flawed, right? And then the data collectors, they have flawed data. And then the rating agencies, you know, for data, flawed. And then the index are created, and that's flawed. And then there's ETFs created on that, and those are quadruple flawed, right? So we have a lot of, systemic error built into a lot of the products out there.
But is that a feature or a bug? I mean, is that a feature or a bug? I mean, is that surmountable? Or is it
It's surmountable, and the SEC right now, and this is going to take some doing, but they're starting to, you know, look at when an RIA, as an example, says they're doing ESG analysis, the SEC is going to start saying, well, show us what you're doing. Tell us how you're doing what you're doing. And so, again, this is a long time in coming. We're still early days in terms of good data. All right. So it's going to take some time. But the analysis that an investor does is very, how should I say, there's a lot of intersectionality there. There's a lot of nuance. And so talk about disingenuous. When a company says, oh, we're going after Sustainable Development Goal 5 on women's economic empowerment, and if they just focus on that, but they're not thinking about, you know, access to education, to capital, to water, to healthcare, to broadband, you have to think about all of that when you want to invest with a gender lens. And so a lot of the stuff that's being done is a bit disingenuous. And so it's early days, so we have a long way to go.
It just seems like it's hard to have transparency when you have so many different factors to look at. Or like if you care about, say, sustainable investing for the environment, I mean, a lot of the big oil companies are also the biggest investors in renewables. So, I mean, where do you draw the line?
That's true. You have to remember that no single ESG data point is enough to make a decision based upon, right? It is a starting point for inquiry. And so once you start the research process, then you know what questions to ask of the oil company that's also doing alternative energies, right? But these are simply data points, again, fundamental, revenues, costs, risk, that are a starting point for real analysis, for deep analysis.
So do you think it's possible for passive investors then to really be in ESG funds? I mean, it sounds like this takes a lot of work.
It takes a lot of work. And, you know, with regard to that question, we don't typically invest passively. We ask our managers, typically we do active strategies with engagement.
Yeah, I want to push back a little bit on a couple of the ideas that this is, it is certainly a sympathetic account to say that this is just about a disclosure problem that we're solving for in providing investors the ability to make decisions.
Okay.
I want to make sure I heard you right before I respond to it. I thought I heard you talking about the fact that actually ESG was about transparency and making sure that investors had the information they needed to make decisions. That was the principal focus of what you consider to be the ESG agenda to be all about.
That's a big chunk of it, but yes, it's a lot more than that. But yes, it's critical.
Okay. Well, look, I think that I've heard that argument before. I think that that is sympathetic on its face. I think there's a couple of issues with it. I think the first is, if we really think it's just about empowering investors to have the material information they need to make decisions, actually ESG becomes superfluous because the current standards governing, current rules governing public company disclosures already make that redundant. And so if it's either it's redundant or it's solving for something other than the non-material factors that go to the current investment decisions that people want to make. That's sort of the first issue. The second issue is that of the full universe of factors that a company could be asked to opine upon, there's sort of great philosophy on this, the questions that we ask, descriptive questions, are actually normative all the way down, which means that the questions that you choose to emphasize for transparency already reflect the ultimate agenda that is embedded into those questions. Because we could equally ask disclosure from companies about what their linkages are to certain autocratic regimes abroad, or people who source their slave labor from the Xinjiang province. And yet the ESG darlings of today, I think many of whom are pursuing the right environmental, social, or governance factors as defined by the current ESG consensus, are still engaging in business practices that may, even on politically left-wing and in other cases apolitical grounds, be deemed to be unsavory business practices that weren't the subject of focus of even disclosure or transparency by the ESG movement, which is why I think the transparency straw man is just that. It's a straw man as a way of serving as a Trojan horse to advance values by demanding transparency, but only on a subset of the total questions on which one could demand transparency. And of course, if one did demand transparency on that full set of questions, then investors would be flooded with too much information in a non-standardized way to be able to make investment decisions at all. And I think that sort of brings me to the third point, which is why it is, if it were superfluous, that we need these new names at all. And I think part of it is ultimately about empowering the people who come up with the names. Conscious capitalism, stakeholder capitalism, ESG investing. I think that these are effectively tools to consolidate power, and there are fees being charged on this by the day. The diversity industrial complex, the DEI industry, is a multi tens of billions of dollar industry and rapidly growing, as are ESG advisors, as are the fees charged on non-passive index funds, non-passive mutual funds that are alternatives to index funds. And I think that this ends up collectively becoming either superfluous or, worse than superfluous, the defining scam of our time, because it's one that, unlike other scams, not only robs people of their everyday money, but robs them of their voice and their identity. And if we're to bring the transparency issue full circle, let's go back to that Exxon example that Jim raised, which is the fact that actually, if people really knew, I'm gonna make an assertion here. It's not supported by data that I'm offering on this call, but I'm offering an assertion that I believe would be supported by data if borne out. If everyone who actually invested in a fund controlled by BlackRock that held Exxon shares in its fund knew what BlackRock's full Sustainability Accounting Standards Board, its SASB, actually stood for, they would not want to have their shares voted in the same way that BlackRock voted their shares. And yet, the single decisive factor in that proxy battle was, of course, when BlackRock decided that it was going to support the activist agenda, that the card had already been played and the decision was foreordained. And so I think actually we can't talk transparency out of both sides of our mouth. If we're actually going to talk about transparency, then we can only do it under conditions where the people who entrust institutions like BlackRock to look after their own personal assets, their money, with a fiduciary duty of the highest order, not a CEO shareholder fiduciary duty, but a custodian of capital, like holder of dollars, kind of highest order fiduciary duty, are actually voting the interests of the people who actually want it. That's the only place where we're going to have sufficient transparency in order for the remainder of the transparency-based argument to hold water at all. So I know there was a lot there, but I had a lot to unpack.
Responses. Erica, you got something to say? It was sort of, he was challenging
a friendly challenge
to the notion of transparency, saying, I mean, we already require material disclosures. That's what the securities laws do and the regulations do. So isn't this superfluous, or is it just window dressing and marketing and what have you? And shouldn't the funds themselves be more transparent, right?
Yes. By the way, your very first sentence, that is exactly the point. The Supreme Court's definition of materiality, right? Would someone make a decision based on this piece of data? Well, what is material is, you know, what's at hand here. You know, is the safety track record of a chemical company or a shipping company, is that material to their ultimate economic outcome? Right? Is governance on whether it's data privacy or regulatory compliance, is that relative to a financial services company or a tech services company? Absolutely. Like, so basically the issue is what is material and what is not? And yes, the Supreme Court has already opined on that. So we're good on that. But this is about disclosure around, corporate disclosure around stuff that affects other people and the planet, other people's lives. Right? So you don't have to disclose on everything. The Global Reporting Initiative has there were hundreds of disclosures, right? SASB, which you mentioned, it's much more skinny down by sector. It's a pragmatic U.S. implementation of the GRI, which is arguably a gold standard. It is pragmatic, right? So there's a few things. And by the way, again, at the beginning of your comments, you commented about ESG being related to values. It is not about values. It's about analysis. And initially, one of the first things I said is that there's no such thing as ESG investing or sustainable or impact or values-based or double bottom line, triple bottom line. It is just investing, right? And so we want to be better investors. And so that's why you want to look at ESG factors. And by the way, when you think about labels, think about what we used to have, the BRIC economies, right? Brazil, Russia, India, China, BRIC. They have nothing to do with each other, right? There's no relationship. It was just a label.
But Erica, I would be in total agreement with you if it was just investing. If it weren't for the fact that there are now tens, if not hundreds of billions of dollars of fee charging fund vehicles raised around calling it ESG investing. So after having raised those funds and raked the fees on it, we can say that actually this is just investing. No, I think we can't have it both ways. And I think the transparency around the underlying issues, including how shares are voted by the very institutions that are raising money under that banner, I think is a precondition for getting to the more romantic view of the problem that you posit.
My investors are investing in funds when they know what the corporate engagement is about, right? And so, yes, there are more asset manager strategies out there than there are stocks, right? Over 60,000 managers rather than stocks. I mean, it's crazy. Right? That's why I work for, at Pathstone, we're evaluating managers all day long. That's what we do. And so I would tell you that there's the real deal and there's the greenwashing fluff. And it is our job to sort through the noise and get to the signal.
And I want everyone to just realize also, Erica is a founding board member of SASB, the Sustainability Accounting Standards Board. If people weren't aware of that, want to turn just a little bit to the parameters of corporate political activism, because I think all of you have sort of said it shouldn't be about politics. You just have a different view of what that means. But what are the parameters here? I mean, if a company thinks going woke will sell more product, why shouldn't they be able to do that? Or should businesses stand up for free market principles, even if it hurts them and costs them profits? What are the parameters here, and how do we view this? Vivek, you've talked about the, in an international context. I mean, people here get upset. Well, the companies are going hard on U.S. states that pass this or that law that seem offensive. but they're not nearly as offensive as some of these foreign governments that the companies say nothing about. I mean, the NBA is sort of a classic example of this. The playoffs are going now, and heaven forbid anyone criticizes China in the NBA, or if you're an actor in a movie, you've got to apologize quickly.
Yeah, I personally think that you are raising actually a good question and a challenge to sort of maybe Allison's and my perspective, which is, if consumers are demanding it, what's wrong with businesses actually catering to the demands of consumers? I have an issue with the investor piece of it, which we just hashed out before, but let's talk about the consumer piece of it. I don't think a business should be barred from catering to those customers. I do think it is part of defining what those customer preferences are to be able to engage in open debate about hypocrisies like that of the NBA, like that of Disney, like that of Marriott, like that of LeBron James or any other celebrity who's speaking out of both sides of their mouth, because that itself informs what those consumer preferences are, that if people can see through that corporate hypocrisy, they will no longer want to buy from Apple, even if it posts Black Lives Matter and criticizes slavery 250 years ago while relying on slave labor today, or Nike or whoever else is guilty of the same thing. Consumers, once they become awake to that, to those hypocrisies, they can recalibrate their own standards. And so I think that that critique of corporate hypocrisy isn't to say that corporations shouldn't be free to be able to engage in behavior that responds to generational or even political attitudes of their customer bases, but rather that that debate is important to inform those customer preferences themselves. And I think that there's a whole separate issue that I think is probably outside of the scope of this panel. There's certainly an issue that I touch in my book, that I also think that there's just a cultural phenomenon that we need to reflect on in American society at present about a new generation of consumers, of citizens, really, that are hungry for a cause and used to have that hunger for a cause satisfied by things like patriotism and faith and hard work. And as those basic notions have disappeared or at least receded in our culture, they are latching on to moralism, even as presented by consumerism, as a way of filling that void. And companies are then able to exploit that void, much as a Virginia Slims advertiser might have exploited teenage girls in the 1990s, such as corporate America exploiting the moral frailties of an entire generation of citizens and buyers today. But that's a separate topic.
How about you, Allison? What do you view the parameters here for corporate, you know, political engagement that may, you know, comport with their desire to maximize profits for their shareholders?
Well, I think we're kind of stuck in a bad equilibrium here. I wonder how much pleasing like a woke subset of the population really does help profits. I get it if you're Nike and you're trying to appeal to sort of a certain age demographic, but I think even within each sort of like Gen Z, you have a whole like plurality of opinion. And like I think we saw with Goya, you know, they had a Twitter sort of boycott campaign and they ignored it and they did better. So I think corporations feel like they have to cow towards this very loud, noisy minority, but it's because I think they figure, well, you know, everyone else will just buy it anyway and ignore it because they don't really care. They just want Goya beans. But I wonder if really it does serve profits and they're in a sort of a bad place now where if everyone else is pleasing them, they feel like they have to too. So, I mean, that's just sort of more sort of a value statement. I don't know if there's I also agree with Vivek. I would never want to say like you must not follow sort of politics of the day if you do think it does help profits. But I do wonder if when you have this more explicit shareholder model, it becomes easier to break out of that bad equilibrium.
So let's step back then from the corporations. I think there's some consensus here, and I would tend to have the same viewpoint. I mean, we normally courts aren't going to second guess this. You know, shareholders might raise these issues, and companies are going to be, you know, receptive to consumer pressure. So if they go too far, they can be punished. But what about now our institutional gatekeepers here? And this is something that we've seen increasingly. You know, Goldman Sachs has an enormous influence over the IPO market. NASDAQ, of course, is one of the two major listing exchanges. Both have come out in recent times, you know, saying, or NASDAQ's case proposing, because they've got to go through the SEC as an exchange, that boards have certain diversity requirements. And that they won't be listed on the exchange, or that Goldman won't take a company public if they don't meet these board diversity requirements. You know, is this inappropriate, and what are the boundaries here?
I'll let Erica go first. I'm curious for your opinion.
Well, first of all, I should say that I believe, you know, unequivocally in diversity, right? Because we have loads and loads of empirical research showing us that diverse teams make better decisions. It's noisy, it's messy, but ultimately, diversity is good. So I'm comfortable saying that. When it comes to gender, as an example, when it comes to quotas, right, I have a real problem with that. I do believe that, you know, gender diversity is kind of a Darwinian imperative. It's going to happen. And here's what I believe is that structurally, systemically, we need to deal with the kind of genesis of issues, okay? And so we can talk about racial equity aside from gender, but if you think about it, there's been, you know, 400 years of white supremacy that has built our country. So we need to go to the issues that made it very difficult for Blacks to build value, to get education, to pass companies down into the next generation. So those are things we can deal with systemically in our investment process. Same when it comes to women, right? So we don't just count the number of women on boards to figure out if this is a good, you know, gender lens investment. We go much deeper than that. Can we get to the systemic issues? And can we get really an equality of opportunity, which starts to get to equity, which is a bigger deal. So my point is, again, we have to be pragmatic. We have to bend over backwards when it comes to fixing the systemic issues around gender. And again, I'm not a believer in quotas. I think we try harder.
So, Vivek, what's wrong with what Erica just said?
Well, I disagree with much of what she said, but she made it difficult to directly attack. It was well guarded by acknowledging that she favors the use of market power to ensure certain conception of diversity while not using quotas to do it, even as that's what institutions like Goldman Sachs and NASDAQ are doing. But here's actually the issue. There's two issues. One is on the content of the issue itself, which I want to pause on, which is, of course, the diversity is good. To me, I agree with that every bit as much as I agree with the truism that companies have to look after stakeholders in order to succeed for their shareholders. Both of those truisms actually obfuscate the underlying agenda that they advance, because diversity is good, but what kind of diversity are we talking about? I personally believe, those are my own experiences, that in the name of diversity, we've actually sacrificed true diversity of thought, and instead we would rather have a visible tableau of diversity of people who actually think more or less similarly to one another by instead looking different from one another based on the genetic attributes that we inherit. And so I think that sacrifice of diversity of thought in the name of advancing diversity of thought is actually one of the great sacrifices in the new modern diversity movement.
And by the way, we have to make sure that I agree with completely. That kind of diversity is not what we're looking for.
But I think that if that were really the case and we were serious about that, we would be talking about axes of diversity other than just racial and gender diversity. I personally think that political diversity and political viewpoint isn't a perfect proxy for diversity in one's perspective in making business decisions, but it might very well be a better proxy than race or gender. Same goes for the economic background of somebody's own upbringing, of under what conditions they grew up. And for me, a guy who, you know, grew up in a middle-class household, went to Harvard and then Yale, and my neighbor who was Black and my neighbor on the other side who was white, the three of us probably have more similar perspectives and experiences than not if we all went through those same experiences. And yet we would together, as long as we had sufficiently diverse races and genders, would count as diverse for the purpose of a board. Yet a straight white male from middle Iowa who suffered from the opioid epidemic might add diversity and have a different perspective on a pharmaceutical company's board. But that may not be the kind of diversity that Purdue Pharma wants on its board, for example. And so I think that's sort of one issue on the content of it. And then I think the use of the market power is the totally separate point. Is what I view as an abuse of regulatorily ordained, legally ordained market power, oligopolistic power by the government endowed on institutions like Goldman Sachs to NASDAQ that get to be regulatorily enhanced gatekeepers for deciding which companies go public or not, using that market power to not just exercise greater power in the marketplace, which is itself a problem, but to exercise greater power in this marketplace of ideas about the very debate that
let's let Allison talk, because Allison hasn't weighed in here. I want to give her a shot here to talk about it.
Yeah, I'm more sympathetic to what Vivek's saying, because I mean, what's the purpose of a corporate board? It's supposed to be, you know, make just sort of spot risks, spot sort of sources of vulnerabilities. And I think you need a diverse worldview really to do that effectively. You want people who bring different things to the table. And as I said, if you are seeking out people who look different but don't think different, you're not going to achieve that. And I mean, I said, like Erica, I'm not personally a big fan of quotas. I think it's better. Certainly, I think you can argue, and I think I'm sympathetic to the idea that we want to sort of build a pipeline. So when we're building a board, you have a very diverse looking group of people to choose from. But I think your first and foremost should be having a diversity of opinion, a diversity of viewpoints, a diversity of life experience. So you can do what a board needs to do, which is, as I said, spot risks, spot vulnerabilities, all those sorts of things.
By the way, here's where you have a systemic problem in that the way boards are typically selected, right? The process by which boards are selected, the CEO, through kind of the other board members, that's really flawed if we're really going to get that diversity. And by the way, I totally agree with that. You know, when we didn't even talk about people with disabilities, we didn't talk about, you know, LGBTQI diversity. There's so much that is
I would argue, as someone who's been on a lot of boards, the diversity of thought matters. And if you're talking about a corporate board, the most important diversity of thought is different industries, different skill sets like law, finance, accounting, marketing, strategy, and you've got to have that on the board. And these other questions. I mean, I don't think the corporate boardroom is the place to remediate centuries-old imbalances and early education imbalances in American society. I want to pull up some of the audience questions. Those of you who have further, because I want to make sure we get the audience involved here. We've got a couple good questions from the audience. One of those is, you know, this looks like this has been a really fairly radical shift almost overnight. And what accounts for this? I mean, the universities, I went to university some time ago. Universities were kind of like this for a while, but the cultural forces have really turned around overnight. I mean, it used to be corporations really tried to stay low key and stay out of politics. Now they seem to want to weigh in. What drives that? Do we have thoughts here, the panel? Anybody?
I have three waves of thoughts, and I've, you know, whatever. I've been spending the last year and a half writing Woke Inc., which you know, meditates on some of these issues. I think there's three main catalysts. One was the 2008 financial crisis, coming out of which the corporations, in the eyes of the old left, were the bad guys who wanted to redistribute corporate power, food money from corporate power to poor people. That's what Occupy Wall Street wanted. This is actually a very convenient way to marry the new woke progressive movement instead, as a way of putting Occupy Wall Street up for adoption, and instead volunteering to use and market power to advance these woke values. That was the 2008 financial crisis. Second thing was the election of Donald Trump, which I think that had an impact on not only American politics, but American culture, such that people who may have disagreed with the prior generation of Republicans kind of became, in many cases, I think, destabilized from their perspective on what needed to be done and what tools needed to be leveraged in order to fight these new forces in our American polity. And then I think that, you know, the issues that spans the last 10 years, including both of those, is the recession of institutions that used to give us purpose and meaning. Things like what I talked earlier, like faith and patriotism and other notions that used to fill our void for meaning. As those have receded, we as a people, as a consumer base, and as a citizenry have turned to commercialism to fill that void, using what I think is the equivalent of a painkiller to treat an underlying cancer. But putting that to one side, I think those are the forces that got us to where we are today.
Eric or Allison, any further thoughts? What's made this blow up so big so fast?
You know, I think it is actually not so fast, not so big. I think people just didn't see it, right? So people like, you know, like me, frankly, who are like, you know, center of the road in terms of politics, I don't want to make corporations political. But I think that, you know, it was just a matter of a few kind of matchsticks, Black Lives Matter, but even much further back than that, right? So the extent to which we have this extreme income inequality, right? The extent to which every 2 years we have a 200-year event in climate. We had so many object lessons, and finally people are beginning to see it. You know, it takes a senator, you know, to turn out that they have a gay son to support gay marriage, right? An object lesson. So I think what we're going to see is this is going to be kind of a pendulum. I think it's going to go back and forth. And right now we're in a place where there's a lot of volume. And one thing, just to get what we talked about, Allison, before, that, you know, sometimes companies might cater to small but very loud and noisy voices. You know what? It's those loud and noisy voices, like Margaret Mead said, small groups of people make huge differences. You need those catalytic voices, right? And we have a lot of them lately, so it's, you know, a huge uptick in activity. What I would also say is one term that we have almost not used at all in this discussion is long-term, right? So much of what happens, you know, we just look at what's going on today. That's not okay. So in the longer term, we're going to see these fundamental issues, and yes, I'll say ESG factors, we're going to see them become material. Right now, some of them might be pre-financial. They're not yet financial. So again, that term long-term, pretty important.
Sure. Of course, we always would discount those as well if we're thinking about it financially. Allison, if you got something further, and I've got another audience question I want to bring up.
Yeah, just quickly, I agree with Erica that this was brewing longer than we realized. I think what we're having is just everyone, corporate on down, just afraid to sort of realize any risk. And I think they think by pleasing this loud, noisy minority who also doesn't want to ever be offended by anyone, and everyone's afraid of offending them, I think it just speaks to a high level of risk aversion all around. And I think that's been building for a long time. And for a variety of reasons that Vivek raised, I think we became a lot more risk averse a lot faster.
Yeah, one thing I would say, and one of our questioners sort of asked this, I do think there's a regulatory overlay here, both from government top-down regulators, and we've seen enormous shifts at the Justice Department and how they handle corporations. I've done a lot of research on this. But also, of course, we've got the long-running issue of the plaintiff's bar, which was brought up by one of our questioners. I do think that these sorts of things create that sort of climate of risk aversion and the people that start shaping these corporate policies. I also think a lot of it has to do with employee base rising up that came through these universities and getting more prominence, and a lot of this is employee driven. Yeah, I want to go, we've got another question from the audience. I want to put this to Vivek, who's been a CEO himself. You know, does stakeholder capitalism increase cronyism within a company?
Within a company is complicated. I think it does, but I actually think that the place where it increases cronyism actually is in relationship to the government. So the obvious form of cronyism, where I think that, you know, to use a Goldman Sachs example from earlier, it was no accident to me that they issued their diversity edict at a time when Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren were front runners in the Democratic primary. And it was widely believed that one of them had a very good chance of becoming the president of the United States, because Goldman Sachs' historical practice of cronyism was to place an alumnus of its organization in the seat of U.S. Treasury Secretary, which it had been particularly adept at doing in ways that had paid off, including in the post-2008 bailout. But now they were potentially contending with candidates that would not be able to accept that currency. And so they just chose to tithe in a new progressive or woke progressive, you know, currency instead. So I think that there's crony capitalism 1.0, which is effectively using corporations capturing government to advance their own ends. But there's a new crony capitalism 2.0 that is actually enabled by this new brand of stakeholder capitalism, which works in reverse, which is actually where government is able to do through the back door using private companies what they could not do directly through the front door under the Congress or through the halls of Congress, under the Constitution or through the halls of Congress. I'll just give you three examples right off the bat. I think that is part of what's going on with big tech censorship online today, where actually you have every few months, these guys call big tech CEOs and say, we want you to censor hate speech and misinformation as we, the party in power, define it. When these guys go back to the other coast and do it, they're effectively doing the bidding of big government because they're threatening them and saying that we're going to come after you with regulation and reprisal and breakups unless you go out and do this thing. It's actually government's actually able to turn these companies into pawns. And we see the same thing with respect to even what we saw in the Obama administration that's coming back in the Biden administration, where there are settlements actually with those big banks. To use the 2008 example, there was tens of billions of dollars of settlements, and yet tens of billions of dollars in settlements were actually never paid by these companies. They paid a small fraction of that sum because they were able to get more than one-to-one offsets by funding left-wing nonprofit groups like La Raza, like the National Urban League, put out nice press releases. Much better to fund those groups than it is to pay a fine to the DOJ and actually pay less money as a consequence. Those are actually tax deductible dollars as well. And yet the US taxpayers end up actually holding less in the public fisc than they were owed under those actual settlements that were entered into. And so that's what I think this new two-way street of stakeholder capitalism is all about, where John Kerry, even very recently, was boasting about being able to leverage his relationships with big bank CEOs to get them to sign on to the climate initiatives or to a climate pledge that actually was effectuating an agenda they could have never passed through the front door of Congress. They're actually able to turn private companies into pawns and Trojan horses. And that's not just the US government, by the way. It is the Chinese government. It is the Saudi Arabian government. Because once we have turned corporations into pawns, it's just a matter of who's actually moving the pieces.
There's definitely backdoor end runs around the constitutional lawmaking process. I talk about this in chapter 13 of my book, The Unelected, How an Unaccountable Elite is Governing America. Shareholder capitalism, Vivek is saying it has an inherent tie to crony capitalism. Thoughts from our other panelists? Stakeholder capitalism has an inherent tie to crony capitalism. True? Disagreement? Well, hearing none, I mean,
it's just like China. Yeah, it's just it. And then, of course, here is where I am going to put values in there. I am extremely pleased that we're going to twist arms on corporates because of, you know, climate change. So that's values, you know, injected in there. But yes, I kind of agree with what you're saying.
Yeah. Yeah, and the question then becomes sort of ends justifies the means, right? I mean, but there is this, I mean, BlackRock's a good example. I mean, the head of Biden's National Economic Council, Brian Deese, was the head of sustainability investing for BlackRock. And before that, he negotiated the Paris Climate Accords for the Obama administration. He happened to go to Yale Law School sometime between when I did and Vivek did. Unlike Vivek, doesn't have a lot of investing experience, but he's now the head of the National Economic Council. Allison, any final thoughts?
Yeah, no, I think this, I really enjoyed this, but remain convinced that shareholder capitalism is the way to go.
Erica, I'll go to you for any final thoughts.
I completely agree with Allison. I think we just maybe define it differently. You know, I think we don't have a real dichotomy. We can do it all.
Vivek.
Well, look, I also want to give a special thanks to Erica for actually representing what ended up being the minority view on this panel. And I can empathize because I'm usually in that seat in a lot of the business community discussions that I'm having. And so I actually think that we ought to be able to have open, unfiltered dialogue about these questions, both on the meta question of stakeholder capitalism, but also actually even the harder questions of the content of certain values like diversity, like climate change initiatives. We ought to be able to do that in an unfiltered way. And I'm a little bit worried that we may be entering an era where people are afraid to engage in that dialogue, but I'm glad forums like this one still exist to prove that we can do it in a civil way.
So I want to thank all of you for participating. I want to thank everybody at Adam Smith for being so engaged throughout this entire national convention. I mean, we're finishing off with some of the big questions. What is business for? How does that interact with the government? Is this form of business organization versus that, and this form of corporate governance versus that, something that's going to be better or worse for business, and better or worse for our society if businesses behave in a certain way? These are precisely the sort of questions that Adam Smith himself engaged with in The Wealth of Nations and The Theory of Moral Sentiments and other writings. So I think it's an appropriate sort of in place for our national convention before the meet and greets and socialization gets there. So I'm going to hand it back to my colleague, Greg Mencken. Thank you so much, Erica, Allison, and Vivek, for your participation.
Thanks so much, everyone. And I think you summed it up well, Jim, that's what the Adam Smith Society is all about. It's a forum to have honest, open, thoughtful, civil and respectful conversation, agree, disagree. That's what we want to try to achieve here at the Adam Smith Society. And we do that through all of our events and programming. Thank you to all of you, Jim Copeland, Erica Karp, Vivek Ramaswamy, and Allison Schrager. It was a fascinating and spirited conversation. I wish it could go for another hour, but unfortunately can't. I want to thank all of you and have a great night to all of you.
Thank you.
That was a great